Alrighty, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Horror Mine, where we explain mysteries, thrillers, and horror movies. My name is Vic Shy, and this week we're taking a look at the newly released Netflix original horror film, Aftermath. Aftermath tells the story of Kevin and Natalie Dadich, a married couple struggling with their marriage after Natalie had an affair. The couple decide to move into a new house in hopes of rekindling their marriage and starting anew. The catch? The house they purchase is where a murder-suicide recently took place. What better way to tackle the harsh housing market than to buy a house that is most likely to be haunted? I'll be going over the events that take place throughout the film and explaining that twist ending that left me genuinely surprised. The film is apparently based on a true story that, by the end of the film, made it all the more horrifying. If you enjoy the video, make sure to hit that like button as it really helps the channel and I would truly appreciate it. But without further ado, sit back and relax and join me as we explore the story of a couple who love making bad life decisions in Aftermath. Our movie begins with a gruesome scene in the aftermath of an apparent murder-suicide. We hear the tragic 911 call made by the female victim as the camera zooms out to reveal the bloody aftermath of the crime. Okay, I'm done with the aftermath puns now. We then meet Kevin Dadich, who is cleaning up the scene of the crime with his co-workers Dave and Garrett. They run into the family members of the deceased, Robert and Claudia, who overhear a crude joke made by Dave about the crime.
Oh no, so you're just an asshole. Or do you prefer douche?
Pretty insensitive there, Dave. We then meet Kevin's wife, Natalie, who is a fashion designer and gets a phone call about an interested financer for her work. Kevin and Natalie are attending marriage counseling as a result of Natalie having an affair. Kevin rightfully feels completely betrayed and isn't comfortable making love to his wife anymore.
You know, you give your whole life to somebody and they're only giving you half of theirs. And the whole time you have no idea.
Their counselor says that they cannot wait for the marriage to rebuild itself and suggests a change of environment to rekindle the flame. Natalie has a conversation with her sister Danny, who feels that she isn't completely to blame for the affair. We learn that Kevin's brother committed suicide by hanging, which made him withdraw from the relationship. I'm no relationship guru, but I'm pretty sure cheating on your significant other after their sibling committed suicide is a pretty dick move. Kevin tells Natalie that the house he just cleaned has been put up for sale and that he was offered a great price. Natalie gets upset by saying she doesn't want to live in a house where she is haunted by the image of someone's brains all over the walls, which is a fair point.
Well, I don't want to sleep in a bed where I have to relive my wife sucking another guy's dick.
Also a fair point. She eventually gives in to buying the house with the condition that it must have a home office and that Kevin must go back to college. They do a walkthrough of the house with Robert and Claudia, who is doing her best to try and sell the house.
But this backyard and the closet space, right?
Ah, yes. Can't forget about the large closet where all the ghosts can come and have a sleepover. They agree on the purchase price, but Robert doesn't seem too enthusiastic about the whole thing. The Dadiches move into their new house, and it isn't long before the creepy shenanigans we all expected start to happen. While unpacking boxes, their dog Odie starts barking at the downstairs closet. Natalie opens the closet and discovers what appears to be scratch marks along the wall. On their first night, Kevin takes Odie to use the bathroom, and upon re-entering the house, Odie seems extremely spooked by an unknown presence that Kevin is unaware of.
Hey, shh.
We also see that the temperature has lowered itself to 31 degrees. Kevin sees the extremely low temperature but thinks nothing of it. Back inside the bedroom, Natalie tells Kevin that there is an intruder inside the bathroom who she initially thought to be Kevin. He goes inside to check, but you guys know it's too early in the film for the entity to reveal itself.
No, there's nobody in here.
If this happened to me on the first night, I would have had the house listed back on the market that very morning. What the hell is wrong with horror movie couples? The next day, Kevin receives a pornographic magazine in the mail with his name on it. He calls the company asking for a refund, saying that he didn't order it, but did he? Natalie has trouble finding her car keys, saying she looked everywhere for them, but Kevin finds them on her work table. Before she leaves for her meeting, she tells Kevin that she packed him a lunch for the day. How sweet. It seems that moving into their new house was a good choice, as we see their relationship slowly starting to get better. You know, minus the ghosts and all. As she walks outside, Natalie notices a suspicious man sitting in a pickup truck parked across from her house, who drives off as soon as she notices him. We also get some really weird editing, as this scene with Natalie awkwardly slows down for some reason. Natalie meets with her investor named Anne, who tells her that she is fascinated by her work. The meeting goes really well, and Natalie is being given a great financial opportunity. Kevin starts his first day back in college and is assigned a project worth half of his grade. He partners up with a woman named Avery, with whom he will be diligently working to finish his project and absolutely nothing else. That night, Kevin surprises Natalie with candles and alcohol to celebrate her new clothing deal. With how good things have been going between them, Kevin is now comfortable enough to make love to Natalie. You can thank the ghosts for that one. That night, Natalie is woken up by the freezing house temperature as we see the thermostat is once again set to 31 degrees. She goes downstairs for a drink of water and music begins playing all on its own. She goes to turn it off and the downstairs closet suddenly opens. She doesn't find anyone inside and closes it. She then notices that the front door is unlocked, and as she turns back around, she finds the closet door wide open once again. She goes back to bed but doesn't tell Kevin about what just happened. The next day, she sees a sweet message written on the mirror, presumably left by Kevin. She thanks him for the note, but he has no idea what she's talking about. Natalie proposes that they have dinner after work, but Kevin lies and says that he has picked up a late shift. He is actually meeting up with Avery to work on their project and get like a little wasted, man. Natalie has a conversation with Debbie, who wants to have dinner with their mom, whom they haven't seen in years. She is reluctant at first, as she doesn't want anything to do with their mom, but eventually agrees. During the conversation, Odie is hassling her to play catch, so she throws his tennis ball into the bedroom, which lands under the bed. She attempts to retrieve the ball, but is unable to reach it. She goes to grab a broom, but upon entering the room, finds the tennis ball sitting right on top of the bed. She then goes to meet Anne's associate for their first business meeting. The associate is a man named Nick Scott, who turns out to be the man that Natalie had an affair with. She tries to leave thinking he tricked her into the meeting, but he assures her that he is strictly there for business. While Kevin is hanging out with Avery, Natalie experiences something terrifying while alone in the home. She wakes up in bed and hears loud footsteps outside approaching her bedroom. She then sees a ghostly white hand appear in the hallway. As she approaches the hallway, an unknown entity suddenly grabs her from behind. Kevin arrives home and finds Natalie passed out on the couch. She tries to tell him what happened, but he passes it off as just having a nightmare. The evening of the dinner with Natalie's mom, Debbie arrives at the house before anyone else. She puts on a nice dress and takes a MySpace selfie in the mirror. She receives a call from Natalie, but ignores it and tosses her phone on the bed. She suddenly hears Odie barking and then whimpering downstairs. She finds Odie cowering on the couch, and the water faucet in the kitchen begins running on its own. She turns it off, but suddenly hears loud footsteps directly above her.
Fuck this.
She runs off but realizes that she left her cell phone upstairs on the bed. Dude, just leave the cell phone and run. Once upstairs, she discovers her cell phone is no longer there. She hears footsteps quickly approaching the bedroom and closes the door. She then hides in the oh-so-spacious closet behind a bunch of clothes. She then hears her ringtone indicating that her cell phone and the unknown entity are right behind her as she is snatched from the closet and into the darkness. Kevin and Natalie come home and think that Debbie bailed on the dinner. They are forced to have dinner with her mom alone, and it goes about as well as you'd expect.
You should probably think about taking I raised two daughters off your resume because you quit that job a long time ago.
So unfair.
Well, at least no one put hands on one another. The delightful conversation is interrupted when Kevin's car gets vandalized for some unknown reason. While speaking to Detective Richardson, he states that the vandalism was a result of a white supremacy social media post which listed the couple's address. The couple is baffled as they have no idea why a racist post could be linked to their new house. Natalie goes to visit Claudia to ask her about the history of the house. We learn that the house belonged to her brother Jay and his wife Erin. Jay had an affair and Erin decided to get even and have an affair right back. Claudia says that the affair was with a mystery man whom she had real feelings for and was definitely up to something. Jay eventually found out about the affair and the couple decided to build a new house, possibly to rekindle the flame of their damaged marriage. Erin designed the entire house, which Jay paid for completely with no questions asked. She says that their relationship was starting to get better and doesn't understand what led to the murder-suicide. Claudia believes that her brother is innocent, saying he would never hurt Erin, let alone commit suicide. She also believes that it's not a coincidence that the security cameras mysteriously stopped working the night of the murder. At this point, it almost seems as if Kevin and Natalie are repeating the same events as Jay and Erin, possibly hinting that the house may be cursed. As Natalie leaves the house, Robert stops her and offers to buy the house back for a cheaper price since she and Kevin are having issues. She refuses his offer, which angers him, and he asks her to reconsider in a threatening manner. manner. Kevin meets up with Avery at a dark park with Odie. Odie suddenly lays on the ground appearing very weak, and Kevin takes him to the vet. The vet tells him that Odie's bloodstream is contaminated with a toxin possibly due to something he ate, and that his heart is failing on him. They ask if surgery is an option, but are told that it would only prolong his pain. They ultimately make the tragic decision to have Odie put to sleep. They return to find flowers for Natalie from Nick at their front door. They have an argument where Kevin feels completely betrayed by Natalie yet again for not telling him that she has been meeting Nick. That night, they both hear something right outside of their door. The unknown intruder seemingly runs off and Kevin gives chase but doesn't find anyone inside of the house. After the incident, the couple decides to reactivate the house's security and camera system, which was already installed in the home. Nick calls Natalie and asks her about the order of clothes she was supposed to deliver but missed the deadline for. She asks him about the flowers and he insists that he was not the one who sent them. She takes a picture of the card with his name on it as proof and discovers that someone took photos of her and Kevin in bed while they were asleep. Music once again starts playing on its own on the gramophone and Natalie hears a loud noise coming from inside the house. Now more paranoid than ever and thinking someone is breaking in, she calls 911 only to change her mind when she sees that the noise was made by a tree branch hitting a window. A ghostly figure with long hair suddenly appears and chases after her. She retreats to the upstairs bedroom and once again calls 911, sounding like the crazy lady who cried break-in. The ghostly figure appears in the bedroom and Natalie tries to run out of the room, but the doorway is blocked by bookshelves. She runs out to the balcony and the unknown intruder grabs her arm, causing her to fall backward and take a dive into the pool. The police arrive but find no signs of forced entry or any intruder inside of the house. Kevin believes that Natalie may have been hallucinating and thinks that she is seeing Nick. Kevin gets called into the police station by Detective Richardson, who shows him the security footage of the previous night. The video does not show anyone entering or leaving the house and does not capture any footage of an intruder. They have a pretty heated argument during counseling as Kevin still does not believe Natalie.
I don't know, Kevin, why are you so concerned with everyone else's feelings but mine?
They take the argument outside because the counseling session apparently wasn't long enough, but Kevin suddenly falls to the ground in pain. The doctor tells Natalie that they found traces of nerium in Kevin's system, a lethal poisoning agent that can lead to serious health problems if taken in small doses over a long period of time. She doesn't allow Natalie to see Kevin, saying that the authorities are speaking with him, hinting that she believes Natalie was the one who purposely poisoned him. She is taken into questioning by Detective Richardson, who believes Natalie is poisoning Kevin so that she can be with Nick, but doesn't have enough evidence to place her under arrest. Natalie purchases a handheld camera in hopes of gathering evidence to show that she's not crazy. Before heading to work, Natalie notices that Kevin doesn't take the lunch she made for him and that he possibly believes she has been poisoning him. That night, a young man rings the door to the house looking really nervous and holding flowers for Natalie. She tells him that he has the wrong house and he suddenly attacks her. He tries to force himself on her, but she manages to fight him off and stab him in the back with a pair of scissors. Down at the police station, Detective Richardson reveals that the man's name is Travis Murray. He says that Travis attacked Natalie because of an online post made to look like it was posted by Natalie. The post claimed that Natalie has a rape fetish and invites any and all gentlemen to her house for some fun. We learn that the post was created by Robert Sorrentino, Claudia's husband who sold them the house. Robert also created the white supremacy post, which got their car vandalized, and purchased the pornographic magazines in Kevin's name. He did all of this to scare them into selling the house as he had a monetary investment in it to help pay off his debt, unbeknownst to Claudia. This is pretty much the only true story that the film is based on and nothing else. The real-life couple were being stalked and harassed in a similar manner by a woman who also wanted to buy their house. However, Robert denies ever breaking into the residence and poisoning Kevin, leaving the identity of the ghostly intruder unknown. That night, Natalie suggests to Kevin that they should probably separate, but he doesn't reply. We see that Natalie has set up her camera on a bookshelf facing their bed. While in class, Kevin receives a text from Natalie telling him not to come home. That night, he goes to Avery's house to work on the project while Natalie attempts to call him on the phone. Avery tells him to pick up the phone and gives him some relationship advice, showing that she truly just views him as a friend and a school partner and wasn't up to anything else. I told you guys. He picks up the phone and hears the voicemail Natalie left apologizing for what she said and that she didn't mean it. Natalie goes for a relaxing bath at home and receives a call from Kevin. She tells him that she never texted him not to come home, but he sends her the screenshot of her text as proof. Natalie goes to look at her camera and the film's crazy twist is finally revealed. In the video, we see a thin, pale man with long hair crawling from underneath the bed and sending the text to Kevin from Natalie's phone. While distracted by the video, the man sneaks up behind Natalie and takes her captive. Natalie wakes up chained to a bed underneath the house. It is revealed that the man has been living and hiding underneath a hidden room located inside of the downstairs closet the entire time, which explains the location of the scratch marks inside the closet. We see that the man had access to the house's security cameras right from his basement, which is how he was able to sneak around without being caught on tape. We also discover that he was the one controlling the temperature inside the house, being able to set it to whatever he wants. One man should not have this much power. The man was also the one who poisoned Kevin and Odie. The man knew that Odie was aware of his presence and poisoned his food to kill him. He is also the one who planted the flowers and blamed Nick to further damage their relationship. Natalie comes to realize that the man is the mystery lover of Aaron, the previous owner and designer of the house. Aaron had an affair with the man and built the house with a secret room so that he could always be with her. She also had several passages installed so that he could freely move around the house, which is how he was able to terrorize the couple without being spotted. Natalie realizes that Aaron ultimately chose Jay over the man, which is what led him to murdering the couple. Also, the man doesn't speak for some reason and walks around looking like the secret love child of Tarzan and Smeagol. Natalie tries to speak to the man to keep him from harming her. The man totally misreads the situation and goes in for a kiss. They then notice that Kevin has returned home and the man leaves the room to go after him. Kevin goes looking for Natalie and sees a head of hair poking out from underneath the sheets. It is revealed to be Debbie's dead body, who was killed by the man, who then texted Natalie from her phone to make it seem like she was okay. Natalie manages to break free from her restraints and is able to scream loud enough, which gives Kevin a heads up when the man attempts to sneak up behind him. The thin, pale, and seemingly malnourished man manages to overpower Kevin and knock him out. He then attacks Natalie, but she manages to disorient him using the flash on her camera. The man begins to choke Natalie, but is suddenly stabbed with the sedative by Kevin from behind, and Natalie goes in for the kill. You could have just given him an eviction notice. The police finally arrive and the couple are taken to safety. 1 month later, we see that Kevin and Natalie decided to sell the house and are almost done packing up. The couple now seems extremely happy and their marriage has surely come out stronger after everything they've been through. They even got a cute new dog. In the film's final scene, the couple and their friends grab the last box and give the house a big ol' middle finger before walking out. After they leave, however, we see the closet door closing on its own, showing that the house is now in possibly always has been haunted, as the movie ends. And that, ladies and gentlemen, was Aftermath. The first half of the film seemed like the typical horror movie with a ton of added drama that didn't really capture my attention. However, I'm really glad that I stuck around until the end of the film. The movie led us to believe that the house was haunted the entire time, only to discover that they were being stalked by a discount Smeagol. The final scene in the film seems to hint that the house is now and possibly always has been haunted. I believe that the house is now possibly haunted by the man who retreats into his closet, doomed to haunt the house forever. I really enjoyed and definitely recommend you check out Aftermath, currently streaming on Netflix. I'm thoroughly impressed with the quality horror films that Netflix has been releasing this year and hope that they keep it up. My friends, thank you all for tuning in, and I hope to see y'all right back here in the Horror Mine. Y'all stick around.